Hello, Cube community. Welcome back to Black Hat 2025 at Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm Jackie McGuire, your practice lead and principal analyst for security and favorite security host at the Cube. And I am here with Martin Zugec. He is the, let me make sure I get your title correct. He is the technical solutions director at Bitdefender. Welcome, Martin. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Awesome. So we've spoken a handful of times before. I'm very familiar with Bitdefender, but for any of our viewers who haven't heard of Bitdefender before, can you tell us a little bit about what you do and your role at Bitdefender entails?
So first, about the Bitdefender, mm-hmm. We are endpoint security company. We do consumer, we do technology licensing, but in my case, I'm part of the business division. Mm-hmm. We have been on the market for a long time, and one thing that makes us special and different, we have been always heavily focused on research. Mm-hmm. So we have hundreds of security scientists that are working with us. We have close ties to academia. We publish a lot of research.
Yeah.
And what I am doing, the way how I like to describe my job, I'm the popular scientist of the company. So I am sitting between all these hundreds of researchers and scientists that we have and public. Mm-hmm. So I am trying to translate the security research that we have into industry education.
I'm also a nerd translator. I feel that's what I do for a living. All right, so we actually did a webinar together. I did a webinar with Bitdefender a month or two ago, and one of the focuses was living off the land. Mm-hmm. So we're going to get, if you could, just give a TLDR of what living off the land is, and then you've got some pretty interesting statistics about types of attacks that use this.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. So living off the land attack is something that existed for decades, essentially, and it is the technique where the threat actors come on a compromised endpoint, network, whatever it is, and instead of bringing their own tool, they just look around and use whatever is already available to them. Mm-hmm. But what we have been observing over the last, I don't know, let's say 3 years, two, maybe 3 years, is that more and more threat actors, ransomware affiliates, are pretty much completely switching to only using living off the land attack, which means there is no malware involved at all. And all these attacks are happening without introduction of any code or anything that can be detected or blocked on these endpoints.
Yeah. And what types of attacks utilize this? Is this like data exfiltration? What types of things are you seeing?
Every single one. So I am doing a lot of, I am helping to publish a lot of research that we do. Mm-hmm. We are looking at ransomware affiliates. We are looking at professional groups that are targeting large corporations. We are looking at instances called lone wolves, where it's a single person that attacks the whole network. We are looking at APTs, and really all of them are using this technique. And again, something that is happening with cyber criminals all the time, they keep experimenting. If one of them figures out something that works, you can see it spreading across this whole ecosystem really quickly. So again, it's all stages of attack, it's all kinds of attacks, like we are seeing it all over the place.
I always say you have to really respect the ingenuity and kind of entrepreneurship of attackers, and I always say if we could only find ways to give those people good things to do before they do the bad things, it would be great, because they're very creative, and as soon as you find a way to defend against one thing, they're like, well, guess what, we found a way to use that against you. So what are some of the most common techniques of living off the land that you see? Are there like really common resources that you see attackers exploiting, or common paths that customers could be easily addressing that they're not?
So I will make this more specific for conversation, and let's focus, for example, on ransomware. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can talk about APTs that we are tracking. Those are more specific, but ransomware affects everyone today. Mm-hmm. So with ransomware, essentially what we are seeing is that every attack can be divided into two segments. Mm-hmm. First one is initial access. That is social engineering, or more and more exploiting vulnerabilities. There is new vulnerability, you have less than 24 hours to patch it now, or they get inside. Yeah. Then once they get inside, very often it can take weeks or maybe months when nothing happens, because what we are seeing is that they are attacking so many companies in such a short time that they need to go over them, and it takes some time.
Yeah. So for dwell times have almost doubled in the last 5 years, right?
Oh, absolutely. It is longer than it used to be. Yeah. So I have anecdote. We've been watching one investigation that we've done, for example. Mm-hmm. There was new vulnerability, less than 24 hours. one of the companies was compromised. Again, like this window is shortening a lot.
Yeah.
And then it took the threat actors about a month before they came back. During that single month, there were 70 more threat actors that compromised the same server. And that is not exceptional. That happens all the time.
Yeah. And I would imagine with AI and the ability to automate some of these things, if you know there's a vulnerability as an attacker, you can just start crawling for it, right?
Oh, yeah.
So it used to be you had to kind of find your targets and try to exploit that vulnerability, but now you don't really have to do the first part of the kill chain. The discovery is automated for you, mm-hmm. right? So what do you think is the biggest challenge with stopping the living off the land techniques?
So
and I know, we're going to solve all of the problems of living off the land right now. So just tell me, we're going to start with challenge and then you're going to tell me how to solve all of the problems.
So we approach this problem academically, again, mm-hmm. something that we like to do.
Yeah.
And what we did is that we investigated 700,000 security incidents mm-hmm. because we wanted to see, first of all, how common are these attacks? We went through 700,000 security incidents, not alerts, but like multi-step attacks. We found out that about 84% of them are using living off the land attack.
Yep. Yeah.
So that is the first thing we did. Then we validated the same data with our SOC. Mm-hmm. They came up with the number 85%. So we are seeing these attacks all over the place. And what we wanted to do is we wanted to compare this with the data where we see how administrators are using the same tools.
Okay.
And the objective was very simple. Hey, here is the list of 20 tools that attackers love to use. No one else is using them. You can just block them. And guess what? We did not make that list. Because what we found out is that the more popular the tool was with the attacker, the more popular it was also with normal administrators.
Mm-hmm.
So at the end, if you want to block these tools that are not used by companies, you still have to leave the tools that are the most useful for attackers. So that is what makes it really, really hard. First of all, there is no malware. So you cannot detect that something is coming from the network on your machines because there is nothing. And second, you just cannot block these tools because your business would not operate without them.
Yeah. And it's crazy, you know, you don't actually have to hack in, right? You can just go buy a login credential a lot of the time. So,
mm-hmm.
And then I try to think about, you know, as a small or mid-market, you know, mid-sized business who's looking at all of this and like, okay, what do I do about that though? Like,
yeah.
if the tools that are most critical to us protecting ourselves, helping our business function, are also the tools that are, because they're very powerful, the favorites of the attackers. So how do I do proactive hardening if I'm a smaller business, if I don't have the resources, if I'm not a giant bank with billions of dollars in budget?
That is a big challenge. And I would say today, the most common protection from living off the land attack, and again, essentially, the most common protection against most of these attacks is really detection and response. So you are reacting. You have someone, you have SOC or you have MDR that is monitoring your environment and looking for anomalies and just responding.
Yeah, putting fires out. Right?
Yeah, exactly. So it's very reactive. Based on this research that we've done, we actually came up with our new solution called Bitdefender GravityZone PHASR.
It's proactive hardening and attack surface reduction.
Yes, exactly. And of course, we came up with the name and then realized the acronym.
It was phasing.
Yeah. The acronym is really good. And
I mean, that's a nerd's delight, right?
Yeah, and it's really at this moment it's based on this research that we've done into living off the land attacks,
mm-hmm.
and there is no similar tool on the market, but. I expect over the time, like we as industry will have to adapt
mm-hmm.
and we will need to start implementing like more preventative controls and proactive security instead of just responding.
So how does PHASR approach detecting this behavior differently than just waiting until something goes wrong and putting the fire out? What's different about how the tool approaches these techniques and detecting that activity before it's an issue?
So PHASR is doing it's combination of few things that are done differently by PHASR.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is, and I could spend 1 hour going into like all the insights from the research.
Mm-hmm.
One of the insights that we have is that in many cases, It is not specific tool, it is specific use or functionality of that tool.
So the ability to move large amounts of data, or the ability to access a specific open port.
Exactly. So what we are doing with PHASR is that in some cases we are looking at the applications themselves or the tools themselves, mm-hmm. but in many cases we are only looking at the partial functionality of that tool that we know administrators never use, but attackers are using it. Mm-hmm. That's number one. So this is all based on our very deep understanding of what the threat actors are doing. What mm-hmm. are the playbooks, how they operate, which tools are they using at different stages of the kill chain. So that is one. The second thing is that PHASR is building these profiles for every single combination of user and machine. So for example, domain administrator that is doing something on laptop, the expectation of PHASR, how he or she should behave, will be very different than domain administrator doing something on domain controller, for example. So it's very easy. We can look at the big parts of the company and we can say, hey, 95% of HR will never use PowerShell. Here is one button where you can just disable it.
Yeah.
So it's this combination of us defining rules based on the research into threat actors, and at the same time, not applying those rules to everyone, mm-hmm. applying them to individual users based on their behavior.
Yeah. And what's the impact on teams when they're able to do that? Like, or is it is it a gain in efficiency? Is it saving money? Is it what, if teams are able to kind of understand these things and proactively start to address those issues, what's the most common benefit you hear from customers beyond I'm not losing sleep at night?
So one of the biggest benefits is essentially you are not disrupting your business. Mm-hmm. You don't have end users calling you, hey, this stopped working, this is not working. So I know it's not like security benefit, but it is, can we actually use this technology in real life?
Yeah.
If we are talking about the SOCs, if we are talking about security analysts, what it means for them is that when they will see any alerts from PHASR, again, like this is based on the playbook of threat actors, mm-hmm. they are going to see this is highly unusual for this user. Mm-hmm. And if you think about it, if you are a attacker, you are trying to keep low profile, you know, I can use this tool for discovery, for data exfiltration. That tool doesn't work. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do? You are going to panic. You are going to think, I need to disable endpoint security, very noisy. I need to download something else, very noisy. I need to move to another machine where I will try to do the same thing, very noisy. So by you are really pushing them into you cannot be quiet anymore. You need to decide between all these bad options that are in front of you.
Yeah. And so if you disable the ability of attackers, they just move on, right? It's one of the things I learned living in the Bay Area is I bought a convertible and I lived in a not great neighborhood. And when I would lock the car, they would cut the top.
Oh, wow.
It's like, if you just leave the car unlocked with nothing in it, they open the door, they see nothing's in it, and they move along. Attackers are not, they're kind of lazy, right? And they're looking for
the quick, absolutely. Easy.
And to your, I think, you know, what you mentioned is they generally compromise multiple customers at once and then go through them one by one. So I guess if you can make it so that they hit a brick wall as soon as they get in, they're going to be like, well, I have 10 other people on the list and I can just pivot, right, to somebody who's...
Well, from perspective of attacker, think about it this way. The reason why they are using these playbooks is that in almost all these attacks, I compromise 500 companies mm-hmm. in one day. Yeah. Then I will go one after another. I'm always going to follow the same playbook. I always know these tools are going to be available to me because they are part of the operating system. Mm-hmm. I know exactly how I can use them. So again, it can be playbook that I just follow in every single one of these victims. If every victim is going to be different, and every system of every victim is also going to be different, suddenly I need to have completely different set of skills.
Yeah.
Because I cannot just follow.
You actually have to be able to hack.
Yeah, exactly. You have to. You cannot just follow. Yeah. Like many of these ransomware groups, they literally have the manuals that are saying, hey, you do this in this order and you are done.
Yeah.
Simple as that.
Yeah.
And it's no longer possible because suddenly you will need to think like, I cannot do this, I cannot use this tool, I need to behave differently. And again, all of this is going to generate some noise. Yeah. So if you have any security operations, you will start seeing high severity alert. You are going to notice like, yeah, something bad is happening on my network.
All right, I know we probably have a lot of viewers who are like want to find out more, and we were talking before this, and I know you've curated a pretty awesome set of content where people can find out more about mm-hmm. how you think about proactive hardening, things they can do, tutorials, so people can find that at your website.
Yeah, so we will include links somewhere.
We'll make sure there's a link in the description, yeah. But
and essentially, what it is that I have I speak a lot at conferences with reporters and such. Mm-hmm. I have the list of the content that is all related to this problem. So it's combination of explainer, this is what living, these are the categories, these are the most common tools. Mm-hmm. It's the research that I was telling about, like, hey, we look at all these hundreds of thousands of security incidents. This is what I learned. And then it slowly goes down talking about different solutions. So it's combination of different content and all of them you can find in one place.
That's amazing. The tribal knowledge that we're able to share in security is what makes
education.
Us a community,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Martin, thank you so much for joining us. This was amazing. I hope everybody comes and finds you, goes and checks out your content, and we'll have you back again soon because we could probably talk for a couple hours about
Absolutely.
This. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Stay tuned. We'll be back shortly with more coverage from Black Hat 2025 at Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas. I'm Jackie McGuire, and we have great guests coming up, so come right back.